know if you've ever had these days or those occasions. Have you ever struggled with words that don't seem to go together? So I'm walking up here, and so what am I going to say? Happy Good Friday. Even just Good Friday seems to be words that, you know, there are words that we often use that don't go together. Ever gone to the restaurant and ordered jumbo shrimp? Seems a little off, something. Someone's clearly confused. Or maybe Hell's Angels, that's a real that's obviously kind of cross currents, right? And Good Friday seems like that, a bit, at first. Until you just go beyond the words of Good Friday. Because today it is this day that we commemorate or celebrate or pause to focus upon the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, the day that he died. It was a painful, horrific death. But we end up calling it Good Friday. Well, again, it can seem to be words that are cross-current until you go just a little further and you begin to embrace the truth and the message of Good Friday. It really, really, really is a very, very good day with an absolutely incredible message that I hope every one of us today will embrace, maybe for the first time or embrace for the 100th time. But I pray that in our moments today, in this service, as we've just been able to sing wonderful songs of worship and praise to God, and a message that we share, and we'll share communion at the close of our service. But I pray that through this day that the message of Good Friday will be clear in your heart, and that we can embrace it again and be strengthened by the truth of Good Friday. What makes it good is revealed when you take a moment to think about what Jesus said as he was dying and what those words mean to us. There's a passage in Luke 23, verse 33 and 34, and I'm going to read them, these verses. And it says, "And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." If you've ever read very much about Jesus or read much of his writings or the writings recorded of his teaching, you quickly come to see that the focus of Jesus' life was people. I mean, everywhere he went, his whole earthly life was completely consumed with his engagement with people. He went about, the Bible says, everywhere doing good. He didn't do good just philanthropic good. He wasn't a millionaire just going around handing out money, but he was doing good to people's lives. I mean, Jesus' heart was focused upon people. We all know how fast technology is changing. I mean, you don't have to look back very far, and you see that some amazing changes have happened technologically. I'm not sure if you've heard of this, but heard about the camera that they say that will show on a screen what someone is thinking. I haven't either, but if that existed, what would it put on the screen for us? Some of you are thinking right now, Pastor, don't ever scare me like that again. I think there's a camera right here, and I'm like, but what if, just thoughts were just broadcast on a screen? I really think that if they put on a screen what Jesus thinks about, you would just continually see people. You would see his love, his desire, his compassion, his heart. Because almost exclusively, Jesus was focused on people, their struggles, their fears, their potential, and most of all, their eternity. And I think today that he focuses for all of us here today, not only on making our life better, because I promise you that following Jesus makes life better. But it's not just about a better life now, because this life is a vapor. It's here and it's gone. This past Monday, I stood beside the casket of Aunt Irene, and she was 94 years old. That's an incredibly long life. But it's 94 years. And you know, all of a sudden, I mean, I remember when 60 was old. I know I should have said 70, I'm sorry. And for then, I should have said 80, I'm sorry. I know. As I inch towards 60, man, it's just amazingly young.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It's incredible how young that is. As I get older, and I think about Aunt Irene, who was 94, and we would all say that's an incredibly long life. And she lived an amazing life. But really, it's short. In the light, or compared to eternity, how brief is that? So, fittingly, the Bible says our life is a vapor that appears in the morning, and then with the sun, it vanishes away. It's just here for a fleeting time. So when Jesus has us on his mind and on his heart, it's not about just a better life now. It's not just about improving the quality of life in the here and now, although it is an absolute truth that following Jesus now is your best life. But it's about more than that. It's about eternity. It's about a fork in the road when we die. It's about two destinations. It's about heaven and hell. And eternity is an amazingly long time. And Jesus went to the cross and he died. And in that death, he took forgiveness to another and a completely, entirely new level. Matthew chapter 18, I'll read. Listen to these words. It says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to bring his accounts up to date with servants who had borrowed money from him. In the process, one of his debtors was brought in who owed him millions of dollars. He couldn't pay, so his master ordered that he be sold, along with his wife, his children, and everything he owned to pay the debt. But the man fell down before his master and begged him, please be patient with me, and I will pay it all. Then his master, this master, this story, this illustration, this parable, this illustration, this master was filled with compassion. And he released him. He released him and forgave his debt. Who does the king represent? Who does that master represent? It represents God. And who does the servant represent? The servant who owed millions of dollars. The servant who owed so much that it was absolutely an impossibility that in 100 lifetimes he could ever pay it. I want to ask how many of you are in debt today. But if you are in debt today, you likely feel that indebtedness. You're aware of it in the form of a payment. And there's a certain amount of focus in your budget. You have made accommodation for that debt. And you pay it. And you chip away at it. And someday the debt's released. How many are looking forward to the day when the debt's completely released that you're carrying that? Sure. But there's no payment plan for the debt that we talk about today. There's no budgeting that we can do to try to alleviate the load and the pressure of the debt that we speak of. The debt that we speak of is the sin that we all were born with. And not only born with, but deal with our whole lives. Now, if any of you have got that all settled and you're never tempted and nothing going on and everything's fine and haven't sinned for, can't remember the last time I sinned 20 years ago, come shake my hand. I'd love to meet you. I'd love to just say, hey, that's amazing. I don't think anybody's coming. That's just what I'm thinking. I don't think anybody's going to approach me today and say, I'm all set there. It is part of our journey that we not only need forgiveness once, but we walk out a life wherein God's mercy, because Jesus on Good Friday went to the cross, because Jesus died, we can be released from our debt. Imagine how you feel if somebody walked up to you today. I don't know how deep you are in debt today. I don't want to know. None of my business. But whether it's a little or a lot, imagine how you feel today. How would you feel if somebody walked up to you and said, listen, I want to know every debt you have, every... That was sharp. I want to know every debt you have. And I'm going to write a check. Or better yet, cash. Anybody want to get at the head of that line? And would you not feel amazing? Would it not feel like... Some of you would probably scream. Robin saying, yep. Because that would be incredible. I want to encourage us all today. Let's never allow it to become, oh yes, I'm forgiven, with almost a yawn, or almost a, it's not that big a deal, it's been like that for a long time. Yeah, I'm forgiven. It's who I am. I hope that God can recreate in our hearts, and no better day than Good Friday for him to recreate in our hearts an amazing appreciation. A thank you, God, that I don't have to live with the load of my sin on my shoulders. It's Good Friday. And it is a good Friday. Because the gospel is good news for the whole world. Jesus died for all. You know, in our culture, there's a growing emphasis on being inclusive. And I think that in some really amazing ways, that it is an incredible, incredibly positive journey. I look at the life of Jesus, and I see Jesus living that value of inclusivity long before it became a slogan or a hashtag. I mean, think about it. In a culture dominated by men, Jesus lifted women up, embraced them. I mean, the woman taken in adultery, this mob of men, holier than thou men, about to stone her for her sin while they carried their own. And Jesus steps into that and literally saves her life. In a culture that had little time or public space for children, Jesus scolded those who would deny them access to him. Embrace them. Talk about inclusive. In a culture that excluded the diseased and forced them to live isolated and lonely lives. I mean, the lepers they had to live in a whole separate colony. I mean, they had to live in a different location, separated from their family. And that's what the culture did to those that were diseased with this disease. And they were forced to live not only isolated and lonely lives, but lives with that disease. Jesus healed them and restored them to a life of dignity. And today we gather on Good Friday. And though it centers upon the brutal crucifixion and death of the Son of God,